Don't worry, there's nothing wrong with your television set. This is a pixie bell. The sound is much too high for human ears. Oh, there you are, Tink. Hey, get that stuff off of me. If you're familiar with the story of Peter Pan, you know that a little sprinkling of Tinkerbell's fairy dust can make you fly. Tink. Tink, wait a minute. Haven't you forgotten something? Aren't you going to take the audience along?
Come on, everybody. Here we go! Up to Neverland!
Fly away with us. Second star to the right and straight on till morning. And discover the behind-the-scenes story of how the timeless tale of Peter Pan was transformed into a soaring Disney classic.
But Peter, how do we get to Neverland?
The story of Peter Pan began its life on the London stage in 1904. It was written by Scottish novelist and playwright James Matthew Barrie. In 1913, a touring company of Peter Pan was seen by this youngster. The boy was Walt Disney. He never forgot this epic of boyhood and its unique combination of fantasy and swashbuckling adventure. In 1924, Walt also saw a silent film version of Peter Pan, starring Betty Bronson as Peter. Walt Disney's efforts to make Peter Pan as an animated feature actually began in the late 1930s, during the production of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, in an era when Disney's filmmaking imagination was at its peak. Walt Disney himself noted, "The cartoon method gave us many advantages over the stagecraft of Barrie's day, which no amount of pixie dust could cure." In 1939, Disney acquired the screen rights, and by early 1940, storyboards were begun. These never-before-seen watercolor illustrations by renowned British artist David Hall were part of Disney's initial work. Hall had also done extensive visual development of Alice in Wonderland for Disney in 1938. In this early version of the story, Nana traveled with Peter and the children to Neverland, as seen in these rare original story sketches. Much of the art created at this time was also darker than the original play, and far more sinister than a typical Disney effort.
Princess, this is my proposition. You tell me the hiding place of Peter Pan, and I shall set you free.
You talk.
You'd better talk, my dear.
This is your last chance, Tiger Lily!
By 1941, a basic story structure was completed. However, the onset of World War II stopped the development. After the war, Walt Disney brought Peter Pan back into development. Progress continued throughout the 1940s, including extensive concept art by renowned color stylist Mary Blair.
The Disney version of Peter Pan has another interesting first. It's the first time a boy was shown as Peter Pan. There had been a tradition from the time of Maud Adams on the stage of women playing Peter Pan. But it was something that was broken, a tradition that was broken by Walt Disney by showing Peter Pan as a boy. Now, it's an animated boy, but it was really a boy's voice, and he was depicted as a boy, which is what he's supposed to be.
Walt assigned the character of Peter Pan to animator Milt Kahl.
I remember hearing Milt Kahl lecture about animation one time, and he said that one of the real challenges for him was animating weightlessness, animating a character who is sort of floating in midair, not flying, but just sort of floating. It's details like that that we in the audience are not supposed to think about. Of course, we shouldn't. We're involved in the story.
Peter Pan will be blasted out of Neverland forever.
To bring the villainous Captain Hook to animated life, Walt assigned veteran animator Frank Thomas.
So I was wondering who was going to get the juicy assignment of doing Captain Hook, and And I heard that Walt wanted me to do it. I thought, gee, putting me on that kind of a villain, a comic thing.
The story man, Ed Penner, had seen him as a foppish guy, grand manners, you know, thought this is the way to live, midnight suppers, wine, all these gourmet connoisseur type things. While the director saw him as a tough, mean guy who'd shoot the cannon and shoot his own crew on the ship, and he was a menacing villain. He was a menacing opponent for Peter Pan.
Now let me see, where was I?
Walt knew that for his version of Peter Pan, Tinkerbell would have to be developed as a fully realized character. From the late 1930s on, character sketches trace Tinkerbell's development, and each reveals the then-current conception of feminine beauty.
The character that I worked on was Tinkerbell, and Tinkerbell was visualized as a spot of light, which no doubt was something like a strong flashlight that moved around on the background of the stage. In our medium, you couldn't just use a spot of light. So I came up with the design that you see here. She's a pure pantomime character, which in itself I think is very interesting, that she didn't talk, but you know what she's thinking.
I was Tinkerbell. I got this call to come over to Disney to do this audition. And they said, we want her to step on a mirror, a hand mirror that's on a dresser, look down, preen herself, and then suddenly see her hips and be very uncomfortable with the size of them. So I did. I said, certainly. And I stepped on and I looked down and I saw my hips and I measured them. I stamped my foot and marched away. And they said, would it be convenient for you to come next Tuesday? So they knew that I had the imagination that they needed.
The use of Margaret Carey as a live model for Tinkerbell was only part of the considerable reference used by Disney animators to bring Peter Pan to the screen.
The second part of my performance after the recording was done was what was really making the film. Although in this situation, it wasn't a film the audience saw. It was only for the animators, and it basically was done so that the animator could watch the action taking place.
The audience always got confused when we talked about live action help. We'd say, well, an artist needs a model. You gotta have something to guide you. But it was also very helpful in little ways of a guy turning and looking back over his shoulder, how far do you turn his head? And you find if you got the real person to do it, this other arm here would come out as he turned, or something come up to his chin, or some little thing you hadn't thought of. And very often that would make the scene come alive.
A codfish on a hook.
I'll get you for this, Pan, if it's the last thing I do.
After nearly two decades of work, dozens of story treatments, and thousands of drawings, Walt Disney's Peter Pan was finally finished. It was first released on February 3rd, 1953, and was an immediate audience favorite. It has remained one of Disney's greatest animated achievements and a beloved classic.
When we watch Peter Pan, guess what? It's all safe. We all come back all right.
It's a story that has meaning for everybody, adults, you know, looking back and seeing this little boy who doesn't want to grow up.
The idea of keeping that youthful spirit, not surrendering your childhood, well, that's a very strong idea and a very magical one that has enormous appeal. And then, of course, it was sprinkled with that Disney magic. Talk about, you know, a perfect marriage, Peter Pan and Disney.
You know, I have the strangest feeling that I've seen that ship before, a long time ago, when I was very young.